Now, Rotarians, coming to the main program of today's evening. Thanks to this corona pandemic, we started conducting our meetings online, and because of which distance barriers are removed, and we are able to get eminent speakers like Mr. S. Prakash. And today, I request Rotarian Yogesh Kulkarni to introduce our chief guest today. Give me 1 minute, Yogesh. Over to you, Yogesh.
Yeah, thank you, Jeevan. So it gives me immense pleasure to introduce Mr. Prakash, co-founder and CEO, SeaChange Consulting, who is also a life coach, an author, and a heartfulness trainer. So Mr. Prakash was born in 1963 and has been a gold medalist in his academic career. And he has been in the training domain since 1987, an entrepreneur since 1992, and has recently won the hat of being in consulting since 2002. Mr. Prakash is an avid meditator, reader, and author, and a turnaround come strategy expert, which is a very sort of relevant subject in today's day scenario. He helps several business verticals in profitability management, leadership, IT, family business transformation, behavioral science, culture, and DNA, and Six Sigma, and sorts. He also has a sort of experience in turning around the entertainment industry, was very keen to understand how that sort of pans out, and has a unique mental conditioning framework for sports verticals. Mr. Prakash is a success coach and helps his clients to practice holistic and spiritual leadership. As an earnest student of spirituality, he has about 3 decades of consistent holistic and spiritual development experience under a capable yogic guide. He spends great amount of time as a volunteer in spreading the message of inner transformation across the globe through several heartfulness initiatives. He is a heartfulness practitioner cum trainer and is secretary to the President Sahaj Marg Spirituality Foundation, also known as Sri Ram Chandra Mission and Heartfulness Institute. He also has authored a lot of books which have been widely published by Tata McGraw-Hill and other publishers. Some of them are You Too Can Sell, You Too Can Be Rich, Future Proof of Your Business, etc. So I would be very keen, and I, on behalf of the Rotary Club of Belgaum, welcome Mr. Prakash, and would be very keen to listen to his insights on how to be a dare-free individual and a personality. Over to you, Jeevan.
Thank you, Yogesh. And now, Prakash sir, the mic is yours. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good evening, dear brothers and sisters. You may be wondering why I'm addressing as brothers and sisters. About 2 years back, it was a great experience when I got a forward from one of my friends in YouTube, which had a beautiful experiment which was done with about 40 to 50 people from across 50 nations, nationalities. You name it, black, whites, whatever. And they were all put through a very unique experiment. For a period of 1 week, they were asked to be together, and initially all their opinions about the other people in the room were all mapped. And during the week, they had all been done what is known as the DNA mapping. This video is available in YouTube. Some of you might have seen it already. And towards the end of it, they brought out all the DNA results. And then they found out that irrespective of the caste, color, creed, sex, religion that they followed, nationality, which continent they came from, they all found that almost 80 to 85% of the people had some kind of a family rooting 3 or 4 generations ahead. I'm very sure that if you do a DNA mapping of all the people who are present in this Zoom call today, in all probability, 80 to 85% of us may be related. That's why I started with the word, dear brothers and sisters. And it also sort of reverberates the words that Swami Vivekananda used in the World Religion Parliament in 1893 on the originally known as the original 9/11, 11th of September, when he started the talk with the famous words, which redefined the way in which the world looked at India once and for all. He started with the famous word, Dear Brothers and Sisters of America. So that sets the base for today's session. If you really look at the topic that I have taken up, I'm thankful to Jeevan that he allowed me to choose a topic of my choice. I thought I would take this because this has a lot of relevance always and also in the current circumstances that the world is going through. That to be free. The word etymology in English normally stands for the root of the word. It comes from a Latin word called as orde separe. Orde separe also stands for dare to know or dare to think for yourself. And an extension of that I change as dare to be free. If you really look at the word free or freedom, it means a lot to many of us. If you ask a person who is in jail, for him to get out of the jail is freedom. For a person who is not happy in his married life, freedom could mean anything. For a student who is writing the exam, when I went through my board exam 30, 40 years ago, the day on which the board exam ended was the best day in my life, not knowing what was coming ahead in the rest of my life. There's so much of sense of relief. In some way, it is a sense of relief from something that you are tied to. From person to person, the word freedom changes. But 3 years ago, when I was reading a book, I had a very interesting revelation for this word, which was used by the author of the book which I was reading. He had very clearly said, freedom is to live the life of your choice under your own terms. Very simple definition, but extremely powerful. It has a lot of depth in terms of what it stands for. To live our life according to our own terms. In this world, is it even possible? How many of us know what is the life we actually have to live to? Many of us, I have about 3.5 years, 3.5 decades of management and leadership and coaching experience pan-Asia. Many of the people I come across literally live the life like a vestibule train. If you have been to Mumbai, which many of you might have, if you get into the train in the morning crowds, you don't need to do anything. You just have to stand in the station. They'll put you inside the train and then push you out of the train in some station without even your knowledge. Many of us get up in the morning, go through multiple boxes and then get out in the evening, go back to sleep, get up in the morning, and the cycle continues. To the extent that 9 out of 10 people I have met in my life, I have met more than about close to about 17 to 18 lakh or 1.8 million people in my training, coaching, and public speaking experience. Very rarely people have really understood what is that they really need from life. How many of us in this call really know what we need from life? I don't know. It's up to you to map. Whenever you're free, you can do that exercise. What do you really need from life? And if you are able to define what you need from life, and then define under what terms will you be able to do it, at least as a first step, you have defined what is your true freedom. The true freedom can be in any field of your choice, one field, more than one field. If you're a doctor, it could be a new invention or maybe even a virus or a vaccine for the current virus that is going on. If you're an engineer, it could be a Taj Mahal or something that you would like to build, or maybe the dam that you have in Mysore, which was built more than 120 years back, which even now stands and talks about the greatness of that engineer who built it. Visveshwaraya, if I'm not mistaken, the Brindavan Dam. Likewise, each one of us, if you are able to define what really is what you seek from your life, and if you're able to do it as per your terms, you have at least as a first step defined what is freedom for you. If you look at the second part of the word, which is actually the first word, dare to be free. Dare is a quality of the heart. How many of us have what we call as the guts to chase the dream or chase what we define as a freedom, which would define our true capabilities to the world? See, I was reading an article about the famous scientist of the last century, Albert Einstein. I don't know how far it is factually true, but at least it makes interesting reading. someone had opined that even Albert Einstein had not lived up to 7% of his true potential during his life. The person whose theory of relativity even today is not really understood by many of us. It's not easy. Imagine even such a great personality, such a great scientist has only used about 7% of the potential. If we have to define, even for example, to at least use 50% of my true potential as a human being, that could be a good beginning that we can start with. And actually, what stops us from even finding out what the definition of freedom is? I want to share a very interesting case study that was done by Harvard over a period of about 35 years. And I'm not joking, it's done over 35 years. You can Google and find this report. This report was about finding out what differentiates great personalities like Thomas Alva Edison, Isaac Newton, Mahatma Gandhi, or any of the great people who stood out in their line in the world, and the normal people. And then they did this experiment across about 75 to 80 countries, spanning over 30 to 35 years. And this research paper came out about 8 to 10 years ago, late 90s or beginning of 2000. And I will summarize it so that it becomes easy for us to understand and connect back to the topic that we have taken up. They had found out that everyone, when they were born with the same hardware that all of us have. Some of you in the call, I see, are doctors. I know for sure that we are all born equal, at least at the time of birth. We all have the same hardware. That's what they also found out. Whether it is Einstein or Edison or Isaac Newton or Gandhi or Jesus Christ or whoever it was, they all had the same hardware, neural network, when they were born. But what differentiated as they grew up was their ability to rewrite the software which was in their own hands, in their thinking. For example, if I give you an iPhone 10 and then put an iPhone OS which belongs to 1X or 2X, what is likely to happen to that iPhone that you have? In all probability, one, it might crash, or even if it works, it might work very, very, very slow, which means you are not getting the best out of the hardware that has been given to you. It's like buying a Ferrari and then driving in a bumper-to-bumper traffic at 5 kilometers per hour. There's absolutely no use. And then they found out actually the reasons as to why this hardware and the software mapping for these people was far different, far better, and far more evolved than many of us. They also found out, incidentally, that everyone who is born has the same possibility of what any of these great beings had gone through. They only finally came out with two simple conclusions. The first, they found out the gap that exists between these great personalities that the world knows them as and what we are is the expansion of consciousness, or their expansion of knowledge, was in great proportions as compared to what we go through. When you speak about consciousness or expansion of knowledge, it's not just about bookish knowledge, but the knowledge that they're able to allow to surface from inside of themselves to great dimensions, which many of us are not able to. The second portion of the experiment is what actually makes the whole thing very, very interesting. They found out what is the root cause as to why the expansion of consciousness or knowledge is so vastly different from these great people, for one in a million, as compared to many of us who are, in their view, in their experiment, were run-of-the-mill stuff. They found out one simple answer. You may be startled to know the answer. It apparently looks so simple, but yet extremely difficult to practice in our day-to-day life. They found out that the entire thing boils down to that ability to ask questions. For example, they said that when an apple fell on Newton's head, imagine all along till then, apples have been falling on so many people's head. What did they do with it? Where Newton just turned it and then asked, why is apple falling? Why is it not going upward? Why should it fall down? And then that led for him to discover the theory of gravity. Not that gravity did not exist before, but he was able to define through which several further applications and scientific concepts evolved. This is exactly what they said is the defining moment. Many of us may be at this point of time thinking, am I not asking questions in this life? All of us are asking questions. But the questions that we ask today are mundane, repetitive questions. What is the business today? What is the billing? What is the collection? Why my staff is not performing well? Why the coronavirus is hitting us? What do I do in this pandemic? Repetitive questions which have been asked hundreds and thousands of times by so many others. That's why Albert Einstein beautifully defined once, if a human being thinks once a year, it's a great achievement. I mean, it's a great definition, very difficult to understand what it actually means. He said, actually, you know, if a human being thinks once a year, it's a great achievement. And then if you go back to the writing of James Williams, also known as the father of philosophy, towards 1880, he wrote the first book, which became the standard for what philosophy is about. There he defined, people beautifully defined, people confuse thinking with reorganization of thoughts. We are either reminiscing or we are hoping for a better future. Actually, we are not thinking. We are just moving thoughts from one place to another inside our head. And then actually we consider ourselves to be doing what is known as thinking. And thinking cannot happen unless you ask questions. And that's why I chose this topic, Dare to be Free. Or a separate really means your ability to know, and that knowing can only come from asking questions. How many times have you asked an original question that has never been asked by anyone else before in their life? Questions normally that are worth asking are questions which will turn you inside out. For example, why am I not becoming another Einstein in my field? Why am I not becoming a Swami Vivekananda in my chosen field? Why am I not yet reaching Mount Everest like what Tenzing and Hillary did? If you start asking such questions, that's why they say that by the age of 3 or 4, we all drop the habit of asking questions. If you look at any of the child between the age of 1 to 4 years or so, what do they ask you? They keep asking questions. And questions, and questions, and questions, and questions. And by the age of 3 or 4, as parents, what do we actually teach them? We just tell them, shut up. Because one, we are irritated, or second, maybe we don't know the answers. The questions could be as simple as, why does sun rise in the east? How many of us can answer such a simple question from a child in the process of rediscovering ourselves in terms of what we ourselves know about the sunrise or the sunset or whatever? It might have multidimensional answers, depending upon whether you answer the question from the perspective of a theologist or a scientist or an educationist or a teacher or a mathematician. The answers can vary. For example, if a child asks, what is water? How many of us today can actually answer what is water? We can only give the chemical composition, max. Or maybe go a little bit deeper and then share a few perspectives about how water can be used. By the age of about 3 or 4, we have taught the children that asking questions is not the way. And on top, adding, once they are 3 or 4, we push them to the preschool system. They move to the normal education system. The moment they step into the school, their creativity is killed once and for all, because they become more of a memory churning machines. Because now the pressure of day-to-day life takes over. They have to score marks. They have to become outstanding students so that parents like us don't feel ashamed to send children there who don't come back with a grade. And in the process, by the time they are in the 10th standard or 12th standard, they're already thinking about how to mug up and get the best of marks. After all, I take a lot of sessions for 10th standard and 12th standard students. In spite of whatever I do, finally they come back and ask, sir, uncle, whatever, how do I score more marks? So finally, it comes down to a rote system of memorizing things. So the art of asking questions has been lost even as a child. And by the time we get out of college, we get into a job and we get into a vestibule system or like a manufacturing, you know, sort of a line. We get in and then we get out on the other side of life. By the time we realize the life is already almost like 60, 65, we are mentally retired. Hence, truly speaking, the ability to ask questions is there in each and every one of us. Except that we are afraid to ask questions. And we also don't have to we rather don't know how to ask questions. There are two aspects when it comes to asking questions. The first is your brain or the unfolding of the brain, which manifests as what we call as mind. And the second aspect of what defines the freedom is your ability of the heart. There are two things which have to work in unison before you can really dare to be free. The first, as I said, is your the ability of the mind to look at many of the concepts which I have been speaking about. And the second is the ability of the heart, which is where the true guts or the daring comes from. Mind by itself does not really dare. Real daring, as they found out, science has found out long ago, that comes only from the heart. That's why you say, you know, people are bold-hearted, warm-hearted, great-hearted. He's a, you know, he's really a strong person, and things like that comes from the ability of the heart. And these two aspects for you to work together, we need to really harness the power of both these aspects that we have. Let's look at the aspect of mind first. How many of us really know how to use the power of the mind? I'm very sure that many of you, having gone through several sessions, through several forums, must have been exposed to the power of the mind. The mind has multiple layers. And right now we are corresponding at the level of what we call as a consciousness space, which is what we call as an awakening stage. And then you have below the surface what is known as a subconscious. This is where the entire definition of what we are as a human is continuously being made up. For the conscious mind, the entry point comes from your physical senses, your sense of touch, your sense of seeing, your sense of smell, your sense of hearing, taste, and things like that. Through this, we construct a life which becomes, over a period of time, what our mental model of life is. But unfortunately or fortunately, there is a passive box, black box, which is lying far, far below, which is waiting to be tapped, which will really allow you to start asking questions, which is the power of your subconscious mind. How many of us really have understood the power of the subconscious, how to tap into it, how to make the best use of it? Many of us have multiple levels of understanding. Some of us have basic understanding. Some of us maybe would have gone through a little bit more. If you look at how conscious mind works, I told you that the input to the conscious mind comes from the five senses. Whereas for the subconscious mind, there is only one input, which is nothing but thinking. That's why subconscious mind works irrespective of whether you're blind or deaf or mute or whether you can smell or not. Because, as I said, dare to think or ode sipere comes from your ability to think, and that is the fundamental ability of the subconscious for you to continuously program how you want. For starters, some of you might have already read this in several blogs that I have written or many of the authors have written. In a waking state, from the time you get up in the morning till you go to sleep in the night, we all have anywhere between 60 to 100,000 thoughts, depending upon person to person. The average, let us say, is about, say, 80,000 thoughts or so. Each of the thought that you have is a veritable seed waiting to grow as a tree in your life. They've done a research, and about 98% of the people in the world have surprising a similarity. Out of the, say, 80,000 thoughts, about 50% of the thoughts are considered to be neutral in nature. For example, I'm standing in a bank queue. I have an option of either depositing or withdrawing money or going up to the counter and coming back without doing anything. If I go to the counter and come back without doing anything, it's called as a neutral transaction. Likewise, as you are watching this seminar, you may be watching me. I am wearing, say, a blue color check shirt. There is a brown backdrop. And then there is a sort of a semi-white wall. All these are neutral thoughts, which has no impact in the construct of your subconscious. Which means actually they are like seeds being thrown on solid ground, which will not germinate or in any way give life force to a tree out of it. Which means 50% of what is potentially our ability to unfold into a future great beings like Einstein and others, already 50% of the input is already lost. If you look at the rest of the 50% of the thoughts that we have, which would help us to construct our mental model of what we can go on to become in life. It is said that out of the rest of the 80,000 thoughts, which is 50%, so 40,000 thoughts are like when you stand in a bank queue. If you have sufficient money in your personal life as well as sufficient money in your bank deposit, would you still want to deposit or would you still want to withdraw when you stand in a bank counter? If you are really smart, if you have enough money, why would you have to withdraw? You would rather deposit. But people in real day-to-day life tend to withdraw. The withdrawal here I am referring to as negative thinking. The negative thinking is nothing but, for example, I can't, I won't, I don't know how I would survive this COVID crisis. I'm really afraid. In very simple terms, all your negative thoughts can be bundled together under just two headings, doubts and fears. That's all. I doubt I can do it. I have a fear it may fail to happen. Finally, about 39,500 thoughts in a day that are actively being used are nothing but 39,500 seeds of lack of belief and fear that you are sowing into the fertile subconscious soil. And you are continuously feeding them. Imagine what is likely to surface out of your subconscious at a later point of time. Who is to be blamed? The creator, the God, the circumstances, or the person who sowed a seed which is coming back at you as a weed? And then we are complaining that the world is not giving me roses. Fortunately, there is still a glimmer of hope. The rest of the 500 thoughts that we have. These 500 thoughts that you have in a day are what is known as positive thoughts. Positive thoughts, in very simple terms, are the thoughts like I can, I will, I am capable, I will surely do. Fundamentally, they boil down to just two categories, hope and self-belief. Hope that the next moment will be better. The self-belief that I can withstand anything and come up against the odds and do. If you have looked at movie space where I do a lot of work, one of the leadership movies that I play in all my sessions is a movie called 300, which is a movie about the Spartans who fought along with the Greece Empire. And over a period of a week, you can find this on the net. It's an amazing movie, which is a true life story. They are about 300 people who are able to manage and stop about 30 to 40,000 people before which the Greece has to go to the nearest seashore and then where the next set of reinforcement is going to come. So the next 1 week or 4 days or 5 days, whatever period, these people have such a self-belief that they're able to manage and hold these people. And finally, they actually lose. All of them get killed. But what happens is it gives Greece 1 week's additional time through which they're able to go and keep the next portion of the battle in the seashore where they actually win. There, what worked is not the numbers which was against them. If you look at any army of 300 people and 40,000 people on the other side, the first thing that anybody would do is to give up and run. Because what tells them practically is that it's not going to happen. 300 is badly outnumbered by 30 to 40,000 people. I was reading a very interesting update. Some of the doctors might have seen this. They found out that the entire active virus in this world, if you really put them in a jar and weigh it will be less than 5 grams. Imagine the entire 120 countries which is under lockdown is being held under lockdown by just 5 grams of virus. Imagine the power of what can happen with that kind of negative thinking or whatever. If you come back to these 500 thoughts, you may be wondering, how is it possible that 500 thoughts, whatever your reach in your life today, you have successful, you own a good business, you own a good car, a house, a good family. All these that has happened because of these 500 thoughts. People ask me, Prakash, how is it possible that 39,500 negative thoughts and 500 positive thoughts, how would it help me to actually lead such a successful and powerful life? If you just imagine you are in a middle of the night in a dark room with no lights on, all it needs for you to bring some kind of a luminance is just to light a match. The room will not be completely bright, but at least it will become a little bit brighter for you to know what is happening so that the fear goes out. That is the power of positive thinking. All it needs for you is that the 39,500 thoughts which are given to you free of cost by nature, by God, or by yourself are available for you to reprogram yourself so that you can start thinking and start looking, how can I really be free? How can I really explore the inner universe of myself to find out what I am capable of? How do I reprogram what we call as positive mental programming? There are several tools that are available, like visualization, self-talk, talking to positive people, keeping a positive ambience around you. A lot of things are there which will help you to redirect these 39,500 negative thoughts into positive thoughts. And then imagine another 40,000 neutral thoughts are available with you for you to use them. 80,000 thoughts every day, 80,000 potential seeds of humongous success is available for every human being in this world. There are still a lot of issues that we need to address. I'll come one by one. Let's assume that the mind aspect partly is now settled. To a great extent, what happens to the mind is a construct of my conscious and subconscious. Many of us are driven by the conscious, and hence what we see, the press, the media, what we feel, what we smell, when we step onto the street, visually we see that the street is empty. We convert that into a negative thought and tell yourself that we are under tremendous danger. I am not asking you to forget social distance or remove your mask. That's not what I'm suggesting. But imagine what is the construct you are giving to the mental model inside your subconscious. Whereas, if you really have to look at how to reprogram all that, you can look at it also as a positive rephrasing. When I look at an empty street, I can look at it as a positive rephrasing and say that I'm learning something the last 100 years many people have never learned in life. I am part of several business strategies group for several large mid corporates and also MSMEs across India. We always say that this is one of the best opportunities for you to defend business. 2 days back, I was attending, talking to a set of leaders. I asked them, how was business 4 months back? When I had met them, many of them 4 months back, 6 months back, 1 year back, you'll be surprised to know the answers I got from many of them. They all said business is okay, business is so-so, profit is not so good, a lot of outstandings, I have inventory pileup which is very, very difficult to clear. And when I ask them today, how is business? I get the same answers. Have things become worse? Have things become been the same? Or is it that the mental outlook of these people on how they had been looking at life been different? Have they been looking through a negative mental model even when things were positive? I mean, if you really look back at life 6 months ago or 1 year ago, I think now at least we know that life was much more positive than what it is today. It is also an opportunity for us to redraw our drawing board. It can't get worse than this. You have hit the lowest of the surface. You have literally dug yourself and gone 5 or 10,000 feet, say, below surface. You can't go any further. That's what the world today has brought us to. It has taught us how to live the business for almost 2 months without liquid cash. I understand the pain point because I deal with organizations ranging from 50 crores to 10,000 crores. And I consult with a lot of them. Of course, the last 2 months, all that is happening over Zoom and long distance phone calls. But one thing they all have understood is that it has taught them how to redraw the board, redraw the strategy, and face life in a better way. Finally, how people face the business is not in their cash, it's not in the stock, it's not in the customers, but it is in their mind. But is it only in the mind? Surely not. There is only one portion of that to be free. There is a second portion, which is what I call as the heart. If you look at the functions of several of the organs, doctors would surely certify that the person is considered to be brain dead, he can still continue to live. I mean, many of us know that without brains, he can still continue to lead life because anyway, we are all living through a recorded message. We all know repeatedly what to do in life, so we don't even have to think through, so we can still live. Many of us actually don't even use the capacity of our brain in full, as was found in the case of Einstein. But the moment the heart stops, you are declared actually dead. Whatever is inside your body, the life force or the soul or whatever leaves you and goes off. The same is true for the humans who run the business also. And they also surprisingly found out that the true guts or the daringness is something which is an attribution If you have seen the movie Gladiator, you will know that the hero finally comes out, you know, all guns blazing. The same is true whether you have seen the 1983 World Cup that India won, or the 2011 World Cup that India won, or several of the near situation where we felt it was impossible to achieve. There was one person who felt, he didn't think, he felt. And feeling is something that comes from the heart. Emotions scientifically are proven to come through amygdala, which is a portion of the lower portion of the brain, which is just above your spine, where it fuses to the brain. Whereas the true feelings come from the heart. When I feel it is possible for me to come back and make it up, none of the things that I really face, I'll just give you one small example. Imagine a situation where I have actually seen some videos on this on the net. There is a mother, there is a small child, and there is a ferocious dog or an animal which is about to attack the mother. Under normal circumstances, if this lady had been alone, in all probability should have run away. But in that moment, they found out that there is something, a courage, something that overtook her. And then she was able to rescue the child by beating up literally animal, which was impossible for her to imagine even a few seconds earlier. When these people were interviewed, they all said, there was something that just told me in the heart that my child or my son or my daughter is much more important. And I had to do this, and something just came through me, and then I was able to do it. The same is true for many of us. It is not your ability to think that is important for you to get out of tough situations. It is your ability to use your heart courageously. And fortunately or unfortunately, courageousness of the heart is not something that you can program through the mind. There are two different functions altogether. Science has been doing a lot of work. And last 10, 15 years, there have been a lot of research which says that even the heart by itself has its own imaginary brain, which lets it function on its own without having to depend upon the brain. The brain function is only for regulation of blood and certain other functions. But surprisingly, there is a book called Heart Map, which you can look up in the net and read it. It has been shown that people who are courageous, even without skills, even without their ability to think, sometimes are people who actually lead from the front and do things which are not easily imagined even by the biggest of thinkers. If you really look at day-to-day leadership, we have the concept of situational leadership. Situational leadership is nothing but there is a crisis which is thrown at a team. How many of the so-called brilliant people who have graduated out of the best IITs or IIMs or B schools or whatever come forward and do the job? Finally, you'll find that the person who has the guts, he is the person who leads it. In 2015, Chennai had one of the worst floods I have seen. I was working in a local community where I was wading through neck-deep water. And little bit of sway here and there, I have been swept away. I'm not an avid swimmer. I know a little bit of swimming I can manage, but not that kind of current. But something told me that you had to lead from the front. Like that, throughout the city, people were actually wading through water, wading through. I saw a lot of snakes as I was going around, a lot of filth floating around. But I just said that to help the fellow humanity, I have to jump in and do something. Whatever little bit portion. And these are the people who actually led from the front till the government machinery kicked in after 2-3 days, and then the national force came in and all that. So what made us do? Is it because I thought through and then my thinking told me that I'm capable of doing? Not at all. I felt from the heart that it is an heart's call. I have to do whatever is the best for my brothers and sisters. Likewise, there are thousands and thousands who are people who grow up on that situation, what I call a situational leadership. What we are going through in the current pandemic is something that calls for situational leadership, an ability to lead from the heart and think from the mind. When you're able to balance both, then maybe you have a semblance of what we call as dare to think or dare to be free. At this point of time, maybe I'll just stop and then throw it open for question and answers, because I was told that you have about totally 45-minute session. I have roughly taken about 35 minutes or so. So I'll now leave the floor open, Mr. Jeevan, with your permission, for people to ask questions till time permits for all of you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I request everyone, if you have any question, please type it in the chat box so that I will unmute you and I will ask you to you. I will allow you to ask the question. Yeah, Umesh. Please, if you have, if anyone has a question, please type it in the chat box.
Maybe Mr. Jeevan, if you have a question in your mind, you can start off so that I don't see anything popping up on the chat box yet.
You can also raise your hand if anyone has a question. You can just raise your hand.
Or maybe the session was comprehensive. There are no questions, I guess.
Yeah, Yogesh is Yogesh wants to ask a question. 1 minute, Yogesh.
Yeah, one question which I had is, how do you ensure that this overshadowing of the negative thoughts over positive thoughts can be sort of minimized? By what is the continuous practice that one should follow to ensure that the positive thoughts overshadow the negative thoughts?
Thanks, Mr. Yogesh. It's a very interesting question. I did cover a bit on that during the session. There are two, three techniques that I teach at a superficial level with which you can start. One is power of visualization, whereby over a period of time, learning to visualize a positive future, you'll be able to see subconscious mind is like a genie out of the, you know, who you have seen in the Alibaba and 40 Thieves. It by itself does not know what is right or what is wrong. It does not know what is possible or impossible. You tell it to go and jump off the wall into a well, it will do it for you. If you tell it to go and take off and then achieve something, it will do it for you. Hence, one of the techniques that you can use is the power of visualization, which is available in my own, I have my own YouTube channel. I have loaded a lot of scripts and all that free of cost. Go to youtube.com / computer Prakash or youtube.com /cchange online. You'll find some of my free videos through which you can learn the power of visualization. The second technique is also what I call as power of self-talk. The words that you use are the words that construct your future, and they come from how you think. If you look at the words that you use in any of the day-to-day conversation with the people around you, it's a reflection of what your persona or personality is. If you look at the words that come out are positive or neutral, or is it out of despair? It defines what you are internally thinking. We always say that rephrase your words. There are two ways in which you can do it. One, change your thinking, your words will think. Or at least, as they say, you know, fake it till you make it. Change your words over a period of time, maybe how you think will change. The third technique is, of course, something Mr. Jeevan might also be able to locally arrange. One of our zonal coordinator, I think, Brother Satish is also on the call today. You can also learn to meditate, through which you will be able to regulate your thoughts and make them positive. These three are immediately techniques which I am sharing. There are more than 40 to 50 techniques which are available, which you can Google and find on your own. And there are enough reading material available. But first, all you have to do, I always tell people, is suspend your disbelief that change can happen. Because I lived a life of 40, 50, 60 years, I have seen many people giving up, saying that it's too late in my life. I've entered the Vanaprastha. I'm waiting for the bucket anytime soon, 10, 20 years from now. Why change? It's never too late to make a change and to become the person that you can become. I mean, 2 days ago, I was watching one of the Times of India pages where a 73-year-old actor has gone back to bodybuilding at home, and he has posted a picture with a six-pack abs. I don't know how many of you saw that. It's quite interesting. He was known to be a very plumpy actor, but he was able to do it at the age of 73. So age is not a barrier. I've also seen a video of an American who was 105 years old, and then he died without any complication. That video is there. And then someone asked him, what is the success of you remaining so positive and healthy throughout your life? At the age of 105 years, he was actually working as a postman in a local post office. out of his own interest. He used the famous two words which are today very, very popular all over leadership circle. He just said, use it or lose it. That's all. So it's up to you. The power to change yourself is inside of you. It's up to you, Mr. Yogesh.
Thank you.
Next, Raj Balagaukar, he wants to ask.
I think you answered a little bit of my question in the question that Yogesh asked. But I'm asking you, are there like 5-minute exercises that we can do during the extent of the entire day, as opposed to, let us say, just a meditation in the morning or late evening, but 5-minute bursts through the day that can calm or basically to dissipate many of the thoughts that tend to clog our mind? Is there anything that you would suggest for that?
Exactly. Way back in 1990, there was a very famous book called as Power of Five, which came up. It's still available on the web. You can buy it, called Power of Five.
Okay.
I have also loaded a lot of videos. When you speak about 5-minute exercises, there are two aspects to it. One for the body, one for the mind. And one, of course, third is for the heart. One for the body, if you go to my site, I loaded several. I am also sort of a health freak. I loaded a lot of exercises that you can do in less than 5 minutes. Breathing exercises, tapping exercises by just sitting and doing, through which you will feel instant rejuvenation at a bodily level.
Okay.
There are also visualization exercises that I have done in 7 minutes of audio messages are available in my website. Even by just listening to them, you can reprogram and learn how to write your own scripts. We also teach spot meditation where you can meditate for 5 minutes and then calm your mind. For example, all you need is just close your eyes and then think that your mind is settling down and you're calm. Then watch your breath slow down and you'll automatically find there is a sense of peace. Let me ask you a question.
Yes, please.
When are you stressed the most? When you're awake or when you're asleep?
When I'm awake.
Yeah. Why you are not stressed when you're asleep?
Because I'm asleep.
Exactly. If you are able to do it, I mean, if you look at the yogic secrets of Patanjali Muni, he has taught Yoga Nidra.
Okay.
And Yoga Nidra is not something that you do when you actually sleep. Yoga Nidra is something that you do when you're actually awake.
Oh.
You can learn it. It's available on the web. Look at YouTube how to do Yoga Nidra. In less than 3 minutes, you can put your mind to calm down. Simple, if you look at your normal pulse, I see there are 2-3 doctors on the call here. The normal heart rate is between 70 to 80 beats per minute. When you do Yoga Nidra or you do meditation, will you believe that sometimes the heartbeat drops to as low as 12 to 14 per minute? At that level, it's impossible for you to feel stressed or anxious, even if you are awake. You're only keeping your eyes closed. All these are doable in less than 5 minutes. Okay. You do it in multiple 5 minutes, it goes on for 15 to 30 minutes. That's all. So I eat 1 spoon of food, I eat 10 spoon of food. Finally, I still eat only 1 spoon of food at a time.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Raj. Next question is Satish Netalkar wants
to ask. Mr. Sunil, I think, has raised a question. Mr. Sunil?
Yeah, first, Satish Netalkar, okay. I have unmuted you. You can ask the question.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. Thanks for your nice thoughts. See, my question is the mindset which controls the body?
I would like to quote from our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who said on assumption of office during his first term in 2014, used a famous term which I quote in several places. He said, Indians do not have a problem with their mind. They have a problem with their mindset. The famous quote attributed to Prime Minister. It does make a huge difference. Right now, I can make you stressed in less than 1 minute. I did this experiment just to show some of the students who are part of my class. We are doing this session in a hotel resort. I just told them, just walk out, look at the waiter who is there, just go near him, look at him curiously and then go off. He did it. And then I call the next student, go to the same waiter, ask him, how are you feeling? Are you okay? And then move off. After 2 minutes, I sent another student who went and asked him, are you okay? You look feverish. By the time the fifth student went, actually the waiter was really feverish. who made the change? Not the people. He allowed someone to infiltrate. I mean, one of the most famous movie which came, Leonardo DiCaprio acted in 2010, a movie called Inception. I don't know how many of you have seen that. It's a wonderful movie. It shows how you can actually plant. And he says an idea is like a virus. The virus can be positive, like bacteria or antibodies. It can be a negative virus, like corona also. But once it gets into the head, it starts building up. But allowing it to get into your head is your problem, not somebody else's. That's why I always tell people to make you feel inferior or superior is not somebody else's problem. It is your problem. If somebody shouts at me saying that I'm an idiot, if I accept that I'm an idiot, I have already become one. For example, somebody is calling me an idiot 200 kilometers away from here. Would I be affected by it? Not at all, because I have not heard it. The same way how you react or respond to other people allows your mind to be, you know, sort of easily programmed, and that's what creates the change. I hope I have answered your question, Mr.
Yeah, yeah. Yes.
Thanks. Thank you, Satish. Next question is from Dr. Damankar. You want to ask a question, Satish?
Yeah. Have you unmuted me?
Yes.
Yeah. See, there are 500 positive ideas coming into each every individual's mind. Why there is then, there is definitely some idea, positive idea must have gone in Sachin Tendulkar's head so that he has become Sachin Tendulkar. Whereas rest of the same ideas, they must be having so many people around, but who have not been able to achieve Sachin Tendulkar's status. Why, what difference does it make between Sachin and others?
Okay, let me now dive into one of my favorite domains, what I call as business strategy. Thoughts by itself is of no use. For example, I have the best of the seed in the world. I put it in the best of the soil. Would it become a tree?
No.
Obviously not. What should I do? I should fertilize it properly. I should fence it so that the animals don't come and eat. I have to water it. And I have to protect it till such time it grows properly so that, you know, weeds and other insects don't attack. Likewise, the thought by itself is of no consequence. I have only given you the beginning of the entire sequence of how businesses are run. For every great business that has gone and become an empire, there are 999 businesses which have failed miserably. And I have studied thousands and thousands of them. Many of my books are based on the research that I've done over a period of 7 to 8 years. What I have found out is that thought by itself only leads to give you a direction as to what you want to do. By themselves, it's of no consequence. That direction will have to be backed by a proper strategy. And that strategy will have to be converted at a field level and executed till such time you reach the goal. In fact, the biggest difference between the people who have made it and the people who have not made it is their ability to be resilient till they reach the goal. When is the 100 meter race over? When you stop at 80 meters, 70 meters, 60 meters, 90 meters, or when you actually reach 100 meters? When you reach 100 meters. This is where many of the business people fail. I have personally advised and coached hundreds and hundreds of them. They all have great ideas. They come out with great products and services, but they do not put a strategy through which they actually back the product. For example, I have a great product or a service. I need to understand the market. I need to understand who are my potential customers. I need to know how to fund this product or business so that it becomes a success. I need to hire the right team. I need to get the right branding people to help me launch the product. I need the right channel for me to distribute the products and services. And I have to educate the customers through proper above the line, below the line marketing strategies for them to know that the product is available. And then I have to put that product or service in the right channel. If it is a distribution product or a pharma product or FMCG product, I have to put it in the right shop. So when the person walks into the shop, he is able to see my product and buy it. And after he buys, I have to follow through and give him excellent customer service. I have to listen to him, find ways in which I can improve the product. The same way Sachin would have done from the time he met Achrekar when he was 4 years old or 5 years old. People would have given him feedback. People would have given him inputs. But what he did, I know Ramesh, I know Ramji Srinivasan, who's the personal coach of Sachin. He's a friend of mine. He told me once, he remembered once Sachin came back from a tournament in USA, having played some kind of a friendly match. he landed in Chennai, where this trainer called Ramji Srinivasan is present. I do a lot of mental conditioning work with him, with some other sports people. He said that the moment he landed, it was close to 2 o'clock in the night or so. He said, morning, 5 o'clock is the gym. He was calling me, Ramji, where I am waiting for you. So what is the difference? He said, just because I have traveled from US does not give me a time for me to go and relax. So tomorrow is another day. I have to again get up and run. As I always quote in all my stories, in the morning in an African forest, a lion and a deer both get up. The deer has to run faster than the slowest of the deer for us to survive. The lion has to run fastest than the slowest deer for it to have its food that day. Either way, you have to keep running.
Thank you. Excellent explanation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr.
Next question is by Sunil Katwe.
Mr. Jeevan, we almost hit 1 hour. Is it okay?
Because it's okay. It's okay. Sunil.
Now, I mean, whatever, I just wanted to ask you, already have told. So, just visualization without action gap doesn't have any meaning at all.
Exactly. It's like getting married and hoping to have a child without getting into the bedroom. People are old enough, I think I can say that here.
Just visualization doesn't only help. You need to have some action.
Exactly. You have to have tremendous action bias, as we say. Because strategy or thinking is only 1% of the work. See, Ratan Tata, whenever he formed Tata Steel 60 years ago, that was one thought and one business plan he came out with. And then he had the support of Rusi Modi and a lot of other great people. But today, whatever Tata Steel has become is because they have sustained that idea over the last 60, 70 years. The same is true for each and every one of your business. If you had given up 5 years back, 10 years back, you would have been finished. If you're sitting and talking here this today, irrespective of whether you have been a great success or a normal success, is because you have not given up. You are consistently getting up and doing it in spite of the COVID challenge, in spite of whatever you're going through. You're still at it. Even on a weekend evening, irrespective of your other priorities, you're ready to sit, listen to certain inputs. That shows that you have some kind of an action bias, which is essential for converting thought into action and be at it continuously for you to see repetitive success.
Thank you, sir. Next question is Amit Sate wants to ask a question. Amit, over to you.
Namaste, sir. My question is, there is a phrase in English, when going gets tough, tough gets going. I just want to ask whether this tough heart is an inborn quality, or you can train a heart to become a tough in tough situation. Why I'm asking this question is, being a passionate cricket lover, there are two twin brothers, Mark Waugh and Steve Waugh. Mark Waugh is a classical batsman, gifted batsman, but he never performed under tough situation. Whereas his twin brother, Steve Waugh, whenever the situation is 17 for 5 or 18 for 6, the person only perform is Steve Waugh. So my question is whether this is an inborn quality, or you can turn your heart to be a tough in a tough situation.
Maybe I'll rephrase the example. 17 for 5 is more suited to Kapil Dev, no? India versus Zimbabwe in 1983. He went on to hit 175, not out in that match. Anyway, yeah. 2 weeks ago, I loaded a video in my channel called When Things Get Tough, Smart People Get Up and Running. More than just being tough, which is a common... I did answer this question differently. I mentioned that there are two aspects for you to chase what is known as that elusive freedom. One is your ability to think. The other is your ability to act, face the consequences. The ability to think comes from the mind. The ability to act comes from your ability to have the courage to face. Hence, I don't say that when things get tough, tough people get going. I would rather say that smart people get going. In exactly the same video, the same topic, I have uploaded in my channel, youtube.com/cchangeonline. Mr. Jeevan may be able to give you the link. I have answered that question extensively there. But it is not about toughness alone. It is about being smart. Your ability to think through the consequences and your ability to act and not give up till the revised goal is achieved. And more than all these things, finally, your ability to keep a team and sustain them. No single human being in the world can ever do everything on their own. Right now, for the last 1 hour, if I'm sitting here and talking to you, it is because my house is being taken care of by my wife. And there is somebody else who is helping us with some other work. if they're not doing the work, I have to get up and run halfway through telling you that I'm sorry, I have a call to attend, or I have to wash the vessels or whatever. Hence, it's your ability as a business owner to have a great team with you, which again is a combination of your ability to lead from the front, which is situational leadership, which is from the heart, and your ability to think through so that your strategy and goal, everything else is perfectly on paper and on hand, very clear. I hope I have answered your question, Mr. Amin.
Yeah, means a heart can be trained, not it should be an inborn quality.
Heart, partly, it's a famous question. Are leaders made or leaders born? One of the famous talk, if you go and do a Google, will be by the former general, Lieutenant Sam Manekshaw. He gave a beautiful explanation saying leaders are made. And there are certain people who say leaders are born. I say that is a combination of both. There has to be a seed. Without a seed, I can't get a tree. The seed is of a good quality or poor quality, you can still put it through certain processes and make it of a viable quality. But the seed still has to be there. Hence, it's a combination of both. But to a great extent, there are certain inborn qualities which are part of the DNA. And there are certain qualities which the DNA can be mutated and then changed by putting you through a process of being with a set of people who make you think in a certain way. They found that in less than 6 months to 1 year, if you're put through a crowd of positive people, even if you have been the worst of negative person, you can be made positive and vice versa.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr.